My task is here to introduce you to the biology of consciousness, a vast subject. So let's start off with the one thing that we are utterly certain of. Philosophers call it, we have a direct familiarity with this. I don't know everything I know about the world, I know by inference. I know about you by inference. I know about the fact that the galaxies and quarks out there all by inference. The one thing I'm utterly undeniable certain of is that the fact that I'm conscious. The content of my conscious may be illusory, but that I'm conscious is an undeniable fact that even if you wake up jet-lagged in a dark hotel room, you have no idea where you are, what time of day it is, you know you are something, you are a conscious entity. And this is the central insight of the most famous deduction in Western thought, René Descartes in 1637. So the difference between brains and other things are that, so brains, this is my brain here. I've colored in the areas of the brain that we think are involved in seeing color, the color blue in that visual illusion that the computer didn't work. So this is what's called the third person account. And then there's also the first person account, the fact that you actually see color, or I have a movie inside my head, I have a voice, there's a soundtrack associated with this movie, right? That's a movie of my daily life. That's the first person account. And so they're external observables that we can observe from brains, their behavior, the fact that they move objects in space and time, and also the behavior of other observables, neurons. You can record their activity, that's what I do for a living. You can track the molecules, etc. So that's all the so-called third person account. But then, of course, what brains have, and maybe a few other systems as well, but certainly we have our brains generated day in, day out, there's this unique internal perspective for them, this first person account. And if science is to have a complete account of everything in the universe, which is, you know, what science is trying to do, then it must account for the most central fact of my existence, for the central datum of my existence, namely my conscious perception and how conscious perception arises out of the physical world, out of physics. There's a wonderful quote here from John Tyndall, the Irish-born physicist who first came up with the correct explanation for why the sky is blue. The passage from the physics of the brain to the corresponding facts of consciousness is unthinkable as a result of mechanics. Granted that a definite thought and a definite molecular action in the brain occurs simultaneously, we do not possess the intellectual organ, nor apparently any rudiment of the organ, which would enable us to pass by process of reasoning from one phenomena to the other. They appear together, but we do not know why. Where our minds and senses so expanded, strengthened, illuminated as to enable us to see and feel the very molecules of the brain, were we capable of following all their motions, all their groupings, all their electric discharges, if such there be, and were we intimately acquainted with the corresponding states of thought and feeling, we should be as far as ever from the solution to the problem, how are these physical processes connected with the facts of consciousness? In modern times, that's known also as the heart problem by this philosopher David Chalmers. It's essentially the heart of the mind-body problem. How can physical matter, how can space and time and energy give rise to conscious experience? All right, let's switch a little bit. What is it we know? We know an innumerable number of facts about consciousness. For instance, we know that consciousness is associated with certain complex adaptive biological networks. Not all of them. My immune system is very complex, has memory. It does its work silently, unconsciously. I have a brain here. We all have a brain in the gut, has on the order of 100 million neurons. Most of the time, you're completely and happily oblivious to the existence of this. When you feel something like nausea, it turns out it's actually the feeling of nausea that you can feel, which requires neurons down here in the enteric nervous system, is generated by a part of the cerebral cortex called the insula. So it's associated with some system, but not all biological systems. We know consciousness does not require motor behavior. We know this because every night, in the privacy of our head, we go to sleep, the external world disappears, and often, during particular types of sleep, an internal world appears that's as real as anything else, right? When you're dreaming, you can't tell, in general, the dream from reality. And at that point in time, in order for you not to act out your dreams, there's a central paralysis. So we, in fact, almost all voluntary muscle, except the eye movements, are paralyzed. We also know this from clinical cases of people who are unable to move and from certain drug-induced cases that you can have consciousness without any behavior. We know that from patients that you don't need these strong emotions. You can have a flat affect. Let's say you're a soldier, you returned from Iraq, you've been grievously brain injured. You talk to these people, they've lost their legs or something, their life has changed fundamentally. You talk to them and they have a totally flat affect. They're not at all concerned about their livelihood. Why? Well, because they lost part of the brain that generates the conscious perception for emotion, but they're clearly still conscious. We know from the clinic and from other cases, from imaging, you don't need language nor self-consciousness. So we humans are particularly proud of self-consciousness, i.e. the ability to introspect, which not all of us have. For example, infants don't have it. Teenage boys often don't have it. They really do stupid stuff. And you ask them, well, why did you do that? And they say, well, I don't know, I just felt like it. And partly that reflects, I mean, self-consciousness involves higher area in the front of the brain. And typically, we don't develop, those connections don't mature. The myelination doesn't mature till in your third decade, till, you know, in the mid-20s or so. We don't need language for consciousness. We know that from patients. We don't need a long-term memory. We also know this from patients like HM or other people that have lost due to viral or surgery. They've lost all access to any of their long-term memory. They're sort of tragic creatures, but there's no question if you interact with them, they're conscious. They might not remember you literally a minute later, but they're fully conscious. And we also know you don't even need attention. It was used to be thought to be closely linked, but we now know through experiments that you can attend to things that you don't see. You can attend to invisible objects. Sort of sounds very paradoxical, but there's lots of scientific evidence to back that up. We know from split brain experiments done in fact at my university at Caltech that you can miss half your cerebral hemisphere, you can still be conscious. In fact, it's remarkable how unremarkable these patients are. And we also know from thousands of brain lesions of patients who've lost part of their cerebral cortex that there's something very local, that local bits, local chunks of brain, particularly of cerebral cortex, give rise to specific content. So you can lose a particular part of your brain and you're unable to see the world in color, or you're face blind, or you're motion blind. If you have ever read Oliver Sacks, he talks a lot about these cases. We also know there are many brains inside your head, but most of them are unconscious, so-called zombie system. So this is a discovery that goes back in Western tradition to Nietzsche and then, of course, Freud. But over the last 100 years, we have very solid evidence for lots of things that go on inside your brain that are very complex, that totally bypass consciousness. Either you don't have at all access to them, or in general, you don't have access to them. Spinal reflexes, eye movements, complicated adjustments of your body that you do all the time, any overtrained routine. So I'm a climber, I'm a runner, I'm a biker. Once you do those things at the expert level, you can do them automatically. First, to learn them, you need to be highly conscious. Once you've trained these things, they're very complicated, you can do them. In fact, you do them best when you're in what psychologists call in the flow. You do them best without thinking about them, without being conscious of the individual action. You just string them together and you effortlessly execute them, and it's a great joy. Reaching, grabbing, generating speech, right? You have no idea how you talk, right? You just, these words come out of my mouth, but I'm not, the conscious Christof isn't sitting inside and composing a sentence in German, then translating it into English, right? These things just happen. I don't have access to the vast majority of my brain. Same thing, I open my eyes, within 250 milliseconds, I see the world in all of its complexity. I don't have access to the underlying neuronal mechanism. So there's a... There's a very rich literature here. Lots of nice experiments done on decision making where you don't even have access. You make a decision, you think you know why, and it turns out experimentally you have no idea why you make some decisions. Now, on the other hand, there are behaviors, so-called, we call them behavioral correlates of consciousness, or BCC, that typically tends to be associated with consciousness, at least in people and in people. So you are an emergency room doctor. You have a patient that's been just involved in a traumatic brain injury, let's say in a car accident, and you ask him, can you move your eyes? Can you move your eyes to the left or right? Can you move your fingers, right? And so if the patient responds in a meaningful way, you assume that he's conscious. And there's a scale that measures this called the Glasgow Coma Scale. Meaningful linguistic content, when somebody says something meaningful, not just yes, 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 but a meaningful sentence, you assume they're conscious. any non-stereotyped temporal delayed sensory motor behavior where you have to do something where you there's an input, you wait 1 or 2 or 3 or 4 seconds, and then you respond. Those tend to be associated with consciousness, metacognition, when you can report about the state of your cognition. You make a decision, and then you're being asked directly, indirectly, how confident are you about this decision? Those are all taken to be as indicator of consciousness. There are lots of techniques that, people developed. This, for example, is a technique called continuous flash suppression. It's probably the most popular technique right now. In your left eye, you put anything you want. Let's say, in this case, an image of an angry face. In the right eye, you flash these constantly changing so-called Mondrians. What you'll see for many, many seconds, maybe a minute or two, you'll only see the, constantly changing images on the right. If you blink with your right, you immediately see the angry face. But if you keep both eyes open, the constantly changing high salient stimulus completely suppresses the other one. So you can use this and related techniques that psychologists have developed over the last 100 years to sneak in things, subliminal things, into your brain without you being conscious of them. And you can do a lot of fun stuff. You can show people naked men and naked women, and although they don't see anything, they, behave appropriately. Lots of interesting, lots of interesting fun stuff, but I'm not going to talk about it. Now, this is important because this allows us to do what Francis Crick, so I worked with for 15 years with Francis Crick, the molecular biologist turned neuroscientist, on this. This allows you to define the NCC, the neuronal correlates of consciousness. So this is the idea that for any one conscious percept, there's going to be a specific neural mechanism, or ultimately a physical mechanism in a particular part of the brain or in many parts of the brain that gives rise to this conscious perception. And one project is, and this really got the sort of the modern study of the modern science of consciousness going, is forget about all these endless debates that we've had with philosophy over the last 2,000 years. Let's just do some good old science. So what we do, we show you something that you're consciously aware of. We show you the exact same physical stimulus, but you're not aware of it because you use one of these masking techniques to hide it from consciousness. And then you look in the brain, for example, using fMRI or EEG, you look in the brain where are the specific mechanisms that only respond when you're conscious of it. Although in both cases you have the same physical retinal input, in one case you see it, in the other case you don't, so that allows you to track the footprints of consciousness in the brain. And so you can, for example, find out for visual consciousness, which is by far the best studied subject, consciousness. Then the neural correlates of consciousness are not in the eyes. In other words, the electrical activity of the eye does not generate your conscious perception. It's not even in the primary visual cortex at the back of your head. There's a bump here at the back of your head. If somebody whacks you there with a baseball bat, you'll see stars. Those are called phosphenes. That's because the mechanical action of the baseball bat is translated into electrical activity in the neurons in, in your visual brain. So we know now, through lots of experiments, you don't even need activity in primary visual cortex. Cerebellum, which is most of your neurons, 2/3 of your 100 billion neurons roughly are here in the back in this little brain called the cerebellum. If you lose that, as sometimes happens due to stroke or virus or cancer, then you get ataxia. You move like you're drunk, your speech slurs, but patients never complain of disturbances of consciousness. So for reasons that, that remain open right now, we don't know, but this part of the brain does not seem to be associated with consciousness. On the other hand, we do know, this is experiments done by a colleague of us, Stan Dehaene and Jean-Pierre Changeux, that if you're conscious of certain things, then particular, so this is you know, the brain here, the back of the brain, the front of the brain. If you're, for example, conscious of seeing a word, well, here the same word is presented, but it's not conscious, you get lots of very widespread activity in different parts of your brain. This is the left hemisphere. You get much higher activity here in this particular part of the brain that seems to be involved in the perception of words, particularly of visual words. Same thing here, if you hear a sound, in both cases, the brain, the same sound is physically present on the ears, on the cochlea, but in one case, the brain hears it, in the other case, the brain doesn't hear it. So these are some of the neural correlates, the neural signature of consciousness. Here you have a picture of two mammals, two female mammals, close to my heart. That's my daughter and a German shepherd. We think both of these creatures are conscious. Why do we say that? Well, A, there's a great continuity of behavior. Of course, the biggest stumbling block to this has been the belief that's peculiar to Western culture of human exceptionalism. There's really no reason whatsoever to believe in human exceptionalism, and so biologists don't, and by and large they talk about the non-human animals and the human animal, because there's this continuity of behavior, of brain architecture, and of course a close evolutionary kinship. So dogs, they don't talk to us directly, they can't speak obviously, but through their behavior, through their eye movement, through their position of their ears, through the wagging of their tail, they can indicate lots of different emotional states. And if you grow up with cats or dogs, you're intimately familiar with that. At the hardware level, it is very difficult to distinguish. So here I took one of these pictures is a piece of human temporal neocortex. The other is a piece of mouse cortex. If I remove the scale bar, and if I give you a little grain of cortical matter, brain matter, from cortex, of a monkey, a mouse, a human, or an elephant, basically, the basic hardware is very, very similar. And it takes an expert neuroanatomist armed with a microscope to really tell the difference. Okay, the basic hardware is the same. No matter whether you look at the gene expression throughout the brain or the different neurons, there's nothing exceptional about the human brain. Indeed, it's not even the biggest brain. The biggest brain is a whale's brain and elephant brains. So there's this great continuity in hardware and great continuity in certainly among mammals in behavior. So therefore, we think we can reasonable with great confidence infer conscious awareness, if not self-consciousness, in creatures that are closely related to us like mammals. So you see there's this progressive step. I know I'm conscious. I don't know directly whether Federico is conscious, but I inferred because his brain and his behavior is very similar. Same thing I do it for all of you, and similar I do it for closely related species. Now there are sort of more harder calls that we are confronted every day in practice. Brain injured patient. There are tens of thousands of these worldwide that are either in what's called a vegetative state. If it's long enough, it's called a persistent vegetative state. Or is it a minimal conscious state? In a persistent vegetative state, the patient opens and closes her eyes, but as far as we can tell, there's no conscious sensation. There's life. They can have brainstem reflexes. Sometimes they move their eyes. Sometimes they can track things very briefly. But there's no repeatable, purposeful behavior. So we think it doesn't feel like anything to be such a patient. But sometimes you're not sure. There are lots of very hard calls that you have to make in the clinic where you're not sure the patient doesn't have behavior because of their injury, but you don't know, maybe it does feel like something to be this patient. That's ultimately what consciousness is. What about when does consciousness start? It's very difficult to tell. Is a fetus conscious at what point? You know, is it at 9 months? Is it at 3 months? Is it at conception? What about a preterm infant like here? What about even a newborn infant? It's not obvious that a newborn infant is immediately conscious. Consciousness is a gradual property. Maybe it emerges slowly. We don't know. What about certain types of anesthesia? There's a phenomenon known as awareness anesthesia. There's a certain type of anesthesia where the brain looks very excited, where it's not clear whether the patient is anesthetized or not. Sleepwalking. Right, where people sometimes do very complex behavior. You know, they can bike, sometimes they can drive, they can open their fridge, they can go to the bathroom, all sorts of things. Typically it's a non-REM sleep, where we are not sure is there any conscious sensation. Then of course there are a vast number of animals beyond mammals where it's much more difficult to infer. They don't have, so the hallmark of mammals is the neocortex. Most animals don't have a neocortex. There are things like this, very complex. There are bees, there are flies, there are worms. And right now it's very difficult to ascertain to what extent these animals, or indeed any multicellular organism, has sensation. Does it feel like something to them? And lastly, there is computers. So over the last 10 years, we all know there's Watson, there is Jeopardy, there is Deep Blue, there are Google self-driving cars, there are things like Siri you can talk to. So we now on the verge of we have created, and we're creating ever more complex creatures that if human were to do what Siri can do, or what Watson can do in Jeopardy, there would be no question we would infer consciousness in these people. So can we deny computers consciousness? And if so, are they conscious? Are they not conscious? What criteria do we need? So for that, we need a theory. And then there are more neurological questions. What about consciousness? Why is the cerebellum not involved in consciousness as it seems to be? What about your cortex during deep sleep? When typically when you wake up people during deep sleep, they report nothing, nothing, nada, not even black, but nothing typically. What about consciousness during epileptic seizure? So there are all sorts of cases where we need a good understanding, is the system conscious or not? So going from the behavioral correlates of consciousness or the neuronal correlates of consciousness, here this fresh human brain, dead brain, to the phenomena itself. This is what Chalmers and what Tyndall sort of referred to as a hard problem. And right now it is hard. But the other way to go is to start with phenomenology and then go towards brain correlates and behavioral correlates. And Giulio is going to talk about that.
I want to show the slide, which is fundamentally useless. But it reminds us that in talking about consciousness, there are always a lot of misunderstandings. And different crowds have different sorts of misunderstandings, often mixed together. Key one is, I want to remind you, consciousness is any experience. You don't need to be self-conscious, you don't even need to be awake, you can be conscious in your dreams. So just keep in mind, consciousness equals experience of anything, red, blue, black, or the anxiety of postmodern man, doesn't matter. Second thing is that, what Christof just said, you can't solve, we believe, the hard problem if you just take the brain and ask, how can it generate experience? But I think you can do something if you start from experience and you ask, how can anything in the physical world possibly generate experience? This is going to be key. Information, as I mentioned briefly the other day, you have to take an intrinsic perspective. You have to ask yourself, what is it like to be a system, which is exactly what happens to us. We happen to be like something when we are conscious. So we want to know what is information from the intrinsic perspective. And so forget for a moment the extrinsic perspective that you see in Shannon, you see in Kolmogorov, etc., which we are used to because it works so well. And finally, integration here means irreducibility. Usually neuroscientists think integration is when something gets to the top. In this crowd, it may mean something even very different. Just keep in mind here it means irreducibility. So now, the integrated information theory of consciousness, which we are trying to present very briefly today, is something that was developed over the years to try to address the problem, the hard problem, from the right side, that is from phenomenology itself. And the way to do that is to describe some axioms of consciousness, that is some essential properties that every single experience you have must satisfy. And here are the axioms we currently think are crucial. And they are illustrated using a drawing colorized here by a physicist and phenomenologist, Ernst Mach, who shows his intrinsic perspective, so to speak, looking at himself from one eye only. And the idea is then that, as Descartes said and Christof reminded us of, experience exists, you exist, you're having an experience. That's an undeniable fact, in fact, the most undeniable fact of all, and everything else is inference. That's the first axiom. Another axiom, which is pretty obvious, is that it is structured. Every experience has aspects to it, different aspects, right and left, top and bottom, hands, books, things, colors, all kinds of things inside any experience, including pure darkness. A key aspect that has been ignored even by philosophers, which is quite remarkable, is information from the intrinsic perspective here. Experience is differentiated. It means that every experience is what it is that particular thing. The one you're having now is a unique kind of experience that you didn't have before, presumably, and it is what it is by differing in its own particular way from who knows how many other experiences that you could possibly have. So it's that particular one in that particular way. Then there is integration. So this has been remarked by people like Kant. Every experience cannot be subdivided into independent components. When you have an experience, it's one. Yes, you can describe the left side and the right side. You can say, I see shapes and I see colors. I hear sound and I understand meanings. But you cannot decouple them. You cannot divide yourself into two parts. One sees the left and one sees the right. One sees the shapes and one sees the color independently. That's simply impossible. Experience is always one. And finally, exclusion. Experience is unique. When you have an experience, there is only one of those. There is no superposition. And what I want to briefly indicate there is that, say, the experience you're having now, let's say, is in color. There is not simultaneously another you who is experiencing the same thing without the color, and another one without seeing faces, and another one without hearing sounds, and another one only the left side, and so on. A multitude of experiences that are defective in one little part. Nor, for that matter, is there a larger experience that includes what you're having plus the value of your blood pressure or what's going on in your gut. So it's always just one. It also flows at a particular spatiotemporal scale. So right now, experience sort of goes, we think, one per 100 milliseconds or so, plus or minus something. And there are plenty of experiments indicating that that is the case. There is not simultaneously a number of other U's that are experiencing things much faster, every microsecond, or much slower, one that can integrate an entire experience across the entire day, say, you know, that you experienced the entire day you had, and so on. It's only one. Now, the whole idea here is to say, if these are the essential properties of every experience, and that definitely exists, we all think there is an outside physical world. How does that physical world have to be structured in order to account for these essential properties? And so here the idea is to get this parallel postulate about the nature of the physical world that can support experience, that go from, say, the existence, so experience exists, then there must be something out there, which we all believe, and that something out there must have certain properties. Well, it first of all should exist too, what supports consciousness, and one way to consider existence, as I briefly mentioned the other day, is that you must make a difference to yourself. So there must be something that has, let's call it causal power. It must be such that it can be affected and can have effects. If it doesn't have possibility to be affected or have effects, it might as well not exist. So we think there are mechanisms out there in a state, for instance, neurons in a brain that are on or off, and they somehow can have causes and effects. If you have a system that has only things that cause it, well, those things are outside the system, like a TMS, a way of, as I will show you, stimulating the brain from the outside that receives no feedback from the brain. That's not really part of the system. We don't experience it indeed. And for the same matter, reason, if you have an fMRI recording all the activity of your brain, even all your neurons, if one day that were possible, but there is no feedback, that would be just a copy of your brain. It would not be part of it because it has no way to affect it on the other way around. Now, composition, experience is structured, translates here very briefly into, well, whatever these mechanisms are that form a system with causes and effects that can generate your experience, they can be structured. And here we see the power set of these simple three elements that I'm going to show repeatedly, in which, you know, some on and some off. You can consider individual elements, so the first order elementary mechanism. Then you have the power set of the combination of two, three, four, and so on. So that's the possible substrate for this being structured of experience. Here is information. Remember, it's one out of many. It's that particular one done in that particular way. And here, as I showed you the other day, is a brief introduction to the notion then that if you have an isolated, in this case, system made of three elements in a state, for instance, the OR gate here is on and the other two gates are off, but think of them as neurons that fire or don't, at least I think of them that way. Well, by the mere fact of being those mechanisms and being in that state, they will have an intrinsic property, which is that of constraining the past and the future of the system. And those probability distributions, the cause repertoire and the effect repertoires, you can calculate. It is basically, if I am, for instance, if you take A, an OR gate, and I am on at the very bottom, then I'm going to constrain the past of the system in a certain way, and I'm going to constrain the future in a certain way. I don't need to do anything. It's just because I am an OR gate and I am on. And this is true combinatorially for all subsets of the system. So information is how you, from the intrinsic perspective, constrain the past and the future. Integration, well, that had not really been addressed in any way, but it's rather an important concept because, as you can see here, we take again that ABC system, that is the information it sort of generates, meaning specifying past and future, but is it a system? As I mentioned the other day, if you are reducible to parts, as a whole, you don't exist. There is no reason to invoke an additional existence of the whole above and beyond the parts. The parts do all the job there is to be done. So here we can test that by cutting a system, literally cutting it with partitions, and finding the minimum partition, the one that is cutting the system in the most effective parts. That is, we ask how much can the parts do for any partition. Once you find that minimum partition, which is indicated there for that system, it's the partition between A, B, and C at the bottom, you see what happens to the information the system generates. Basically, what are the cause-effect repertoires that are left after you do the cut. And then you can measure a distance between the distribution of cause-effect repertoires before the cut and after the cut. That's how much of a difference it made to make that cut to the system. And if you go for the minimum partition, we know that that system is at least that much, that distance above its part. It does something as a system. We can quantify that with a quantity called phi, which stands for integrated information. This is essentially capturing the notion to what extent is a system physically irreducible in terms of the information it specifies. Now, this is true for the system as a whole. How much is the set of cause-effect repertoires reducible? It's also true, we think, for the individual sub-mechanisms. That is, each element specifies its own past and future. Is that mechanism reducible? If two elements together don't do anything above and beyond the parts, then they don't do anything within the system. And finally, exclusion. As I remind you, there is only one experience, and at a particular spatial-temporal scale. But let's just look at space here. So again, we have system ABC now embedded in an outside world with inputs from E, for instance, and output to D. Now, there is no particular reason why we should have chosen system ABC as our system, the one that eventually might be conscious. We could have chosen AB only, BC only, AC only, or the entire system of five elements. So the idea here is that what you want to look for is a maximum of integrated information. In other words, you want to ask, what are the set of causes and effects that do the best job in explaining what the system does to itself? And you choose that and only that. Anything else doesn't exist because its job has already been done, so to speak. And if you do this systematically for every subset, you'll find that ABC has the maximum of integrated information. Anything smaller than that or anything bigger than that is less. And so we say that ABC is the unique thing that generates your experience. We apply the same logic to the sub-mechanism within the system. So A, for instance, could have several kinds of cause-effect repertoires, but we cannot accept the idea that you can multiply causes, that you can have many things causing the same effect. So there is only one cause, and that is the most irreducible cause. There's a lot more to be said about that, but at least that's the idea. And finally, this brings us then to the notion that once we do all of this crazy combinatorial work, which takes a long time to do even in a computer, you find that, say, that system ABC in that particular state is a maximally irreducible entity in terms of causes and effects onto itself. That is the set of cause-effect repertoires it specifies which are irreducible, and it is called a maximally irreducible conceptual structure. And the system itself is called a complex, the one that generates a maximally irreducible conceptual structure. We shorten it into a quale. And the right side just plots those cause-effect repertoires, those distributions, into a space that we call qualia space, where each axis is a possible state of the system in the past and in the future, and each star is one of these irreducible cause-effect repertoires, which we call concepts. And the size of the star is how irreducible the concept is measured by the value of small phi max, 0.5 in this case, from one particular star. It says, if this, then that, essentially within that system. And big phi, 1.92, is how irreducible the entire conceptual structure is. So in general, for any system, we could do this analysis, and we could come up with what it says about itself and how much it says about itself. And the key identity that integrated information theory proposes is that an experience is a maximally integrated conceptual structure. And it has a certain value of phi max, big phi max. That's how much it feels like to be that. That is the amount or quantity of consciousness. And it has a particular shape, if you wish, in qualia space, the set of its irreducible concept, which is what it feels like. So both the quantity and the quality of consciousness are in principle accounted for. And according to the theory, this is indeed an identity. There is nothing more or less. It is like to be that particular system in that state. So let me now show you just a few examples that follow from the theory, some corollaries, just a few, and then I'll give you a couple of predictions. So if you assume then that that is the case, in general, one corollary will be that any system will break down into complexes of larger or smaller size. For instance, this bigger system here boils down into ABC, the one we saw before, which is a complex that specifies a maximally reducible conceptual structure, which will be conscious in that particular way. But there are also other small complexes which are completely isolated from it, even if there are interactions among them. So everything condenses down into loci, like my consciousness, your consciousness, his consciousness, even if we talk, we are all separated, as we know to be the case, and we can measure it in principle. It also shows the influence of architecture. Here you have a sort of modular architecture in A, where you have a set of elements which are interconnected, but in a certain way. It turns out this breaks down into individual little consciousnesses, very, very minimal ones with two concepts each, but there is no larger entity at all. So So you don't have one big consciousness, you have a lot of small ones. In the middle, you have another interesting system, five elements, all-to-all connectivity, majority rule, if more than three, fire, I fire. And in that case, the system is one complex, it forms one entity, but it has only five concepts, and they're all elementary concepts, the ones specified by each individual element. And by the way, they're all the same. So there's only one star, if you wish, in the past, in the future. It's a totally trivial system with a minimum value of big five. So it's minimally conscious, only conscious of one little thing, this and not this. On the right is a system with five elements, same logic, but only three connections per element, and they are different from each individual element. So we have introduced some differentiation. It's not homogeneous like before. Now suddenly it is still one entity, so it's a complex, but big phi is much higher, it's 10.75, and it has 30 different concepts of elementary and higher order. So now it is like something to be that system, and it's something more interesting than before. It breaks many symmetries. So we assume this is sort of true for many systems if you could analyze them properly. Another obvious consequence is that the consciousness can be graded. You can see here by changing the strength of the connections, which can happen in our brain, from high to medium to very low, you can have one entity with high consciousness, so to speak, another one with much less so, but still one entity, and then it breaks down into sub-entities. We think that happens when you go into sleep, as I'll show you. Another counterintuitive consequence is that a system made of inactive elements that supposedly do nothing, okay, these are copy gates that just do nothing at all, they are all off, these could be neurons that are off, will still generate consciousness of a certain kind. So you don't need to pass messages around or signal, it's an intrinsic property of something that is and has that ability of constraining the past and the future. Another consequence, you can have a very simple system, like a photodiode with memory there, which can actually generate a minimal amount of consciousness. That's actually the smallest amount. We call it really minimally conscious. It is like something to be that photodiode, although it's so trivially low that it doesn't even make much of a difference to talk about it. But it is a minimal distinction. It's this rather than not this. It doesn't matter whether you have a photodiode, a blue detector, or a thermistor. In that case, intrinsically, it just feels like just a little bit and nothing more. An interesting consequence is that a purely feed-forward system disaggregate, disintegrate. It's not a system, according to this theory, so that, in fact, if you take even a very complicated feedforward system, there is nothing it is like to be that. You can show this because recursively nothing can act back on itself, and therefore there is nothing there. We can use it, but it doesn't feel like anything. And a key consequence of that is that you can build two systems, one on the left, which is recurrent, and one on the right, which is the equivalent, purely feed-forward version of that recurrent system, which have exactly the same input-output function here up to a t equal 4. So they do exactly the same job. You could treat them, they behave equivalently for any question and answers you want to get from them. And yet, if you do the analysis according to IIT, the one on the left feels like something, is something, exists. The one on the right, we can use it, but it doesn't exist at all in and of itself. So there is functional equivalence without conscious equivalence. Let's leave this out because it's too complicated. Let me just show you some predictions of the theory. So these are very rough predictions. If consciousness has to do with integrated information, and we can't, of course, measure it properly in a real brain, well, let's do something rough. Let's go for something that sort of captures the idea of integrated information in those cases in which we know that consciousness changes in a radical manner. And these include sleep, include anesthesia, include brain disorders of various kinds. So we used, together with Marcello Massimini, transcranial magnetic stimulation, which is a way to induce a current in a particular part of your cerebral cortex, and high-density EEG to record the responses of the brain. And we did this in subjects when they were awake, and they were, for instance, in deep sleep, the time which, if I wake you up, you have nothing to say. So in that case, if I show you now the currents generated by the brain when I perturb a particular region, it doesn't matter which one, when you are awake, you see that there is a strong local response under the coil when you stimulate, and then it moves around, these are the peaks of activity, all over the place for roughly a third of a second. So you can see this is a complicated pattern of activity where an electrician going in, stimulating the brain, responds in a complicated manner. And it does so, as I said, for roughly 300 milliseconds or so. That's typical when you are awake and conscious. Now we take the same person, say exactly the same spot, exactly the same intensity, when the person now has been 40 minutes into deep sleep and he is not conscious at all. And what we get now is that the local activation is just as strong, if not stronger. The brain is active and it is reactive, we know that. But curiously enough, now the activation doesn't go anywhere else. It remains localized, as if the system has disintegrated into local domains, and you can do it in different places. You activate that place, but it doesn't go anywhere. Somehow, even if neurons are there and the neurons are active and reactive, it doesn't integrate well. This is what happens qualitatively. We see a sort of snapshot of all this complicated activity superimposed in time. In wake, in deep slow wave sleep, you lose integration, you break into pieces. And in REM sleep, when you dream, it comes back. So it doesn't matter whether you're awake or asleep. And finally, we can actually try to quantify this, so it's not just qualitative. And we use here Lempel-Ziv complexity. Assuming the system is integrated, then how differentiated it is, sort of how compressible the pattern of activity is, should be a rough indication of information integration. We binarize the currents after source density analysis. This is the spatial temporal matrix, the places in the brain and time. We try to compress it, so we zip with TMS and we zap, you know, with Lempel-Ziv. And what you get is that in wake, you have a matrix which is hard to compress. In sleep, you have a matrix which is easy to compress. And you may even get a big response, like at the bottom, if you give a very big pulse, but it's homogeneous, and so it's easy to compress again. So it fits with the notion of integrated information. This PCI is a perturbational complexity index. It's basically inspired by phi without being phi. And this is a recent study in which, in collaboration with a group in Liège and with Marcello Massimini, we showed that these are all individual subjects. This value of this rough, you know, integrated information proxy in the brain measured with TMSEG is high in every subject, every individual subject when they are conscious. Then when they go into deep sleep, or these are three different anesthetics, midazolam, xenon, propofol, all different mechanisms of actions. Every time you lose consciousness, it drops down to 0.2, 0.23 or so. So systematically, each individual subject does as it should be. These are brain damage patients, the sort that Christof showed you. At the very bottom are vegetative patients who are unconscious. The index is always very low. Then on the right, at the very top right, there are patients who are locked in, who have no behavior, but we know they are conscious. In that case, it's as high as in you and me. And in between, there are these complicated cases, minimally conscious patients, sometimes behaviorally can't tell. The index gives you something that suggests whether they are there or they are not there. You don't need to communicate with them. This is based on a theory. It works in each individual subject in many different conditions. And so far, they had nothing like that that can sort of tell us, based on a theory, whether you might be there or not. So I'll leave it to Christof to finish.
Integrated information theory can sort of extrapolate to these cases that are much more ambiguous based on the circuit complexity in the cause-effect repertoire. But the one that I wanted to mention is this remarkable prediction of integrated information theory that says, although you can get systems that are equivalent to within a certain time step, in terms of their I/O behavior, which is typically how we assess, of course, in the Turing test. A Turing test is all about input-output behavior. So here you have two systems on the left and on the right, the ones that Julie showed before, that have the same I/O behavior. Yet one, they have very different circuitry. So one has this heavy feedback circuitry, the other one is a purely feedforward system. The theory says quite unambiguously that the system on the right has no phi. The system is reducible to its component. It doesn't exist in this sense, but of course it can act. It can, for example, process information. It can detect faces. A lot of the standard machine vision algorithms, for example, the Google cat detector, are of this ilk on the right. They are a series of cascaded feed-forward systems. These deep learning networks are nothing but a set of standard neural networks that are cascaded one after the other. So the theory would say, although these systems do perform useful computational function, i.e. they find faces and cats, they don't have, it doesn't feel like anything to be them. Which is really quite, so here the theory really differs very much from the standard way of viewing. It's not about the input-output behavior, it's about the internal circuitry, the internal cause-effect repertoire. So there are a number of systems that do not have sentience, that do not have conscious. On the one hand, IT says many, many systems that have complex integration going on, including possible or multicellular organisms, or possible or biological organisms, or even beyond that, may have a phi different from zero, i.e. it feels like something to be the system. It's not standard panpsychism, right? Standard panpsychism claims that everything is ensouled, everything has consciousness. A dumb system, a system that has no states, for example, is not conscious, like, you know, if you want to think about a grain of sand. An aggregate of systems, if I just take a bunch of individual systems, so for example, here, if we consider the consciousness associated with this meeting, it is not, there isn't any meta-consciousness, it's just the consciousness of aggregate, it's just the consciousness of the individual components. Unless the degree of interaction is so high that it extends the integration within my brain, and then you can have a meta-conscious, you can have this higher über-consciousness, the theory would then also predict that the individual consciousness would immediately become extinguished. So as I said, feed-forward computational systems are not conscious, and there's a very interesting case of computer simulation. So we, the field is setting out to model, or has done over the last 20 years, does very large-scale modeling. There's now a human brain project in Europe that has the goal over the next years to try to model a human brain. In the limit, once this becomes possible, let's say in 50 or 100 years, we can ask, will this, if, assuming that this entity, this perfect human brain model, can simulate the I/O of the brain. Most people would say, well, if it simulates all the causal elements of a brain, then of course it's conscious. But the case is much more difficult, as you saw in this previous case. It really depends on the underlying circuitry. Now, in particular, on digital machines, of course, ultimately they can all be reduced to Turing machines, right? So you have this one-dimensional Turing machine, although it may be a very, very big one for the human brain simulation. So you really have to ask the phi associated with the simulation is not the phi of at this meta level, but actually would be the phi of the Turing machine, and ultimately the phi of underlying of the underlying hardware, and that may be zero, it may be very small. So the relationship between consciousness and what's being simulated here is very complex and may be very different than most philosophers or people who think about these imagine. And then lastly, of course, I just wanted to leave you with this, my last slide. This is the most complex artifact people have ever built. It has on the order of 10 to the 18 components, and I'd like to, transistors, right? This is one depiction of the internet. And if you just count the transistors in this internet, it has 10,000 times more transistors than synapses in the average human brain. So it is complex by any measure of complexity. We don't know at this point whether it has any phi, but I think it's an interesting question. At least it's a question that we can now at least have a meaningful way to reason about. It's not a crazy question. To what extent does it feel like anything to be such an entity? Thank you much.